You are listening to Productivity Straight Talk with your host, Amber De La Garza. Amber is a sought-after productivity coach, trainer, speaker, and writer who gives entrepreneurs the straight talk on personal productivity. No BS, fluff, or overused jargon. Just actionable strategies to get results and succeed in business. And here is your host, Amber De La Garza, the productivity specialist.
Welcome, and thank you for listening to Productivity Straight Talk. Today is episode 196, Focus at Will, boosting productivity with personalized music with Will Henshaw. If you're a business owner who wants to improve your time management and elevate your productivity so you can maximize profits, reduce stress, and make time for what matters most, then you're in the right place, and I'm so glad you've joined me. I'm looking forward to bringing my guest to you because you get to meet Will Henshaw. Will is a Los Angeles-based tech entrepreneur, inventor, and music producer. He was the founding member and main writer of the UK pop soul band London Beat. Their massive early 90s hit, I've Been Thinking About You, reached number one in the Billboard charts and was the top-selling single in all major territories and won him BMI PRS Songwriter of the Year. In the mid-90s, he founded San Francisco-based auto tech company Rocket Network. The Digi Delivery Media Transfer System, now part of the Pro Tools 12 Cloud Collaboration. It is the standard tool used every day in pro audio production for TV, movie, and music. He sold his company to Avid in 2003. His most recent startup is why we're talking to him today, and that is Focus at Will, a science-based driven instrumental music streaming service, over 2 million users, that helps people at work and study reduce distractions and be more productive. He holds 5 patents and has 1 new in the oven. Oh, I can't wait. I hope we hear a little bit about that today. All right. So if you've heard about Focus at Will in the past and already know what it is and you want to jump in and take the quiz, you can do that by going to amberdelagarza.com/focusatwillquiz. It's really quick. I've already taken it. You answer some questions about yourself, and then it makes channel recommendations on what channels will enable your focus. If you want to sign up for Focus at Will directly without taking the quiz and get 1 week free, you can do that by going to amberdelagarza.com/focusatwill. Now, what you need to know about this interview is that I actually was not a user of Focus at Will prior to him reaching out about being a guest. And I am now a user and an affiliate. So if you do use these links, I will get a small percentage, but I thank you for supporting me here at Productivity Straight Talk. And you may know that I am only an affiliate for products that I use and I think have a real positive impact on you or your business. And the reason I said yes to this interview was, in fact, to ask all the questions that I was so intrigued about with regards to, can you really increase your focus with different types of music based on the different types of brain types you have? And it was so interesting to me because as I was preparing for my interview with Will, I was writing down and kind of journaling and thinking about, where has this shown up that I actually intuitively have known this to be true? And how have I seen this impact clients in my private coaching? How have I actually seen this impact my son? And I share those stories with Will, and so you'll hear all about that in today's episode. You're also going to hear Will and I talk about some feedback that he's gotten from surveys of thousands and thousands of people about some uncommon ways that people show up their most productive selves. And I found it incredibly fascinating, and I'm certain that you will too. While we are talking about utilizing music and sound to really create the ability for us to have that laser-focused time, you are going to hear he and I talking about the power of focus and how much that actually impacts our ability to be productive. We have an entire training called Freedom to Focus that is inside Leverage Lab, my coaching, training, and accountability experience. Inside the masterclass, I teach you how to unlock, find, discover your special focus formula. Because you are different than me, and I have known that for a very long time. And so I walk you through step by step and guide you through discovering what that is and then showing you how to create that environment on purpose. I actually truly believe that we have it to be our job, our responsibility to unlock and find how do we show up our best. And once we do that, then your primary responsibility is how do you do that on purpose more often? Could you even imagine if you were able to unlock that for yourself, that zone where you're like, I can do my best work. I feel like I am showing up my best. You are being your most productive self. And there is so much positive feedback emotionally and in our businesses when we show up our best. And so it is your job to figure that out for yourself. But you don't have to do it alone. You can do it inside with me inside this masterclass. This masterclass is just one of 13 masterclasses that live inside Leverage Lab. So if you want to find out more about Leverage Lab, head on over to amberdelagarza.com/Leverage Lab. And now let's meet our guests and get to the straight talk. Welcome to Productivity Straight Talk, Will. How are you today?
Hey, great to be here.
I am really excited. Now, this is going to be, and I say that a lot when I have great guests coming on. You literally ended up in my inbox this week, and then we got to schedule it because as soon as I saw what we're going to be talking about, my brain was so curious. I couldn't wait till we had this conversation. So thank you so much for reaching out.
Productivity is a big thing for me, I gotta say. I hate to waste time.
That's right. That's right. All right. Well, let's not waste any time and start off with, can you share us a little bit about what we're not going to hear in your bio? And what is a little bit more about Will and how did you embark on this journey of starting Focus at Will?
Focus at Will is a music service that has a unique library of music that is specifically designed for people when they're working. Now, a lot of people, actually two people out of three, like to listen to music when you're working. The problem is, what do you listen to?
Right.
What do you listen to? Because if you listen to music you like, that's music with lyrics, that's music with vocals of any kind, music with trumpets, you know, this is music that is designed to engage you. And so while you're working, so sure, you know, you're working away at work, maybe you have a cubicle or you have a desk and there's a lot of noise over there somewhere. You can block out that by listening to some music. What you've just done is you've substituted one problem for another. We've all done that. So now you're singing along with ABBA's greatest hits or whatever it is that you like. And we found, we've been doing this for 10 years and we found there are very specific types of music. We'll talk a little bit later on in the interview about how you find that and what those different types of music are based on your brain type. This is a unique service. You can't find this music, these versions. It's all instrumental and you can't find it anywhere else. So,
and did you find it 10 years ago to be so counterintuitive? Because most people would assume to be your most focused self, to be most productive, that just was assumed in a quiet work environment.
Yeah. Most people have heard of this thing called the Mozart effect. There's a sort of a folklore. You can look it up on the internet. People will tell you, yeah, you can listen to Mozart. It makes you more productive. That's not true. For some people, it is true, but it's not true for all people. And the most insane, I'll play some examples of some of the Focus at Will music, actually. One of the things that really was counterintuitive when we started off was when we realized that, let's say you have a friend who is super hyper. We've all got friends. Some of my favorite people are like Elon Musk level of hyper crazy. They're like 2 hours, always, never stop, right?
Right.
So if someone's like that, we would intuitively say, listen, why don't you listen to something gentle? Why don't you listen to some sort of calming classical music? Maybe something like this to just calm you down. That's so calming. Because if someone's really hyper, we just want to calm them down, right?
Right.
No, that won't work at all. I mean,
and why does that not work?
Because, counterintuitively, the more hyper you are, the more stuff, the more energy you need. And if someone is really ADD, the kind of music that works best for them is this. This is another channel on the Focus at Will system called ADHD Type 1. Here it goes. It's just warming up. If someone is ADD, they will actually find this relaxing.
And you know, I'm going to pull something from my past to say that makes sense. My brother has ADD. And when he was a kid, the doctor would say to give him coffee
right,
to calm him down.
Exactly. So what this is actually doing is it's clocking the brain in a very similar way. That's exactly right. Most people are not ADD as such. About 5% of the population are. Most people are kind of in the middle and they need something to pick them up. And there's a channel on the Focus at Will system called Uptempo, which is the sort of uptempo trance kind of electronica. And nearly half of our users listen to this channel. It's got a pulse. Moves along. Tap your feet. It's 128 beats a minute. If anybody's a DJ, deep house. So a lot of people like this. For some people, that's a little too much. And so we have another channel on the system, which is sort of a chill version of that. It's called Alpha Chill. A little slower. Now, what's really interesting about this is that I'll just leave this on in the background while we're talking. When you're playing music for working and you're trying to get into a vibe, a flow state for working, what you're trying to do is to get your non-conscious attention to listen to the music so your conscious attention can do the thing you're trying to do. So we humans have two parts of our brain. There's my conscious attention talking to you. I'm going to turn this off because it's actually distracting me while I'm trying to talk to you. There's my conscious attention, which is me talking to you right now, Amber. Mm-hmm. I'm like focusing on you, da da da. And my non-conscious attention, which is usually my ears, it's everything I'm hearing, is allowing me sort of evolutionarily, it's allowing me to focus and concentrate on you. Now, if there's a door slams here in my office, or there's a loud noise, or I hear someone shouting outside my door, my non-conscious attention is going to be like, wait a minute, this could be dangerous. You know, the caveman impulse is there in the brain, and I'm going to be like, hang on. Amber, I got it. I can smell smoke, and I think there's someone shouting outside. I got to go do that, right?
Yes. Now,
that is something called a fight or flight, something that happens in your brain. And this response is built into us all. Everyone has it. Different humans, though, have different levels of sensitivity to that. And if someone is hyper, someone is just by definition, just really crazy all the time, as I said, like a chihuahua, their sensitivity to things around them is much greater. And it means that, like you were saying, your brother has ADHD, it means that for him to be able to concentrate, he has to have a lot of stuff happening in his brain or around him for his brain to be able to concentrate. We have one of our science advisors is called Dr. Ned Hallowell. He's a psychiatrist. He's based on the East Coast of the States in Massachusetts. And he's really interesting. He's done a lot of research on ADHD and how to manage it. And of course, there are pharmaceuticals. Everybody knows that you can give kids Adderall and somehow it calms them down. But he also found that if you have a child with ADHD, about every hour, just under an hour, you can send them out to a trampoline in the backyard. You can have them bounce furiously for 10 minutes and come back in. They've kind of used up that extra energy and they're able to sit and focus and concentrate, especially if you then play the music like I played earlier on, which is this extremely intense, very loud ADHD music, which I'll just remind you sounds like this. Oh, it's so relaxing. Well, if you have ADHD, it is. I'm talking about ADHD because, here we go. Some of our most productive, most talented people have attention problems.
Absolutely. Right?
And in fact, in my own life, if I look at my favorite humans of all ages, you know, my dad, for instance, these are folk that just can't sit still. Always on the go, always doing a bunch of things. Yet when they are focused and productive, wow.
It's amazing, right? I have found that there's a lot of entrepreneurs that have that tendency and they feel like there's something wrong with them or like that's the reason that they can't be productive. Sometimes they have those stories. And I love that you've done the work to unlock how they can show up their best.
Yeah, yeah. That we have on the Focus at Will website, which is focuswill.com, there's links to the white papers and the research that we've done around this. There's a stigma about having ADD, ADHD. They're both the same thing. ADHD is the sort of the hyper version of it. There shouldn't be. There shouldn't be. It just means that to be able to work and be productive, you have to have more things happening in your surround.
Yes, I agree. And I see a lot of clients that do have ADD or ADHD or even self-diagnose because they haven't learned their best way to find focus, right? They're thinking, there's got to be something wrong. I can't focus. And what I share with and teach my clients is that they need to find their own focus formula. Mm-hmm. And the focus formula was actually created almost 10 years ago myself by accident. And I'm going to share this story because this is exactly why I wanted to meet with you. I worked in corporate and I was in management. So, you know, every good manager has their door open and the cubicles are outside and there's hustle and bustle and lots of motion. And when I left and decided to start my business, I was like, surely I'm going to be more productive. Like, I got this. I'm going to be quiet in my office. Uh-huh. This is the perfect environment. Well, I sat here where I'm sitting talking to you and I'm in front of a big window in the front of my house. And remember when you were referencing the fight or flight? I have a tree outside my window and I would curse at the bird that landed on the tree and the mailman that would drive by. And every single little noise distracted me far worse than the office. And I literally was scratching my head and thinking, well, that's really weird. It's so counterintuitive. And so the first 18 months to 2 years, anytime I wasn't working with a client, I actually would sit in a local cafe. The owner of the cafe was like, I'm going to start charging you rent. Like you're running a whole business out of the corner of my cafe over here. And for me, instead of like just sitting in judgment, it made me curious, like, well, how can I replicate where I thought I had just trained myself to work best? So I worked in the cafe on my laptop for all that time. And then I realized I could probably make that same situation in my office. But I'll tell you, I never found cafe recorded music. And you guys have a plethora of it, right?
Maybe I should just put some on in the background so you feel kind of especially productive.
Right? It's been so long since I've actually worked in the cafe, but I would say that I wish that I knew that something like Focus at Will existed because I would pack it up, go drive down to the cafe, all so that I could get in my zone.
Yeah, when we started this, I'm the same, by the way. I find it impossible to work in a library or a quiet place. It's not my thing. And we're based here in Los Angeles. And there are three of my favorite local cafes here in LA. And I was like, they're slightly different sizes. The cafes are different, right?
Yes.
I was like, some days I choose to go in. This, the one that we're listening to right now, is the medium size. You can't really hear what people are saying, but you can hear stuff. This is a channel on Focus at Will. This one here is the slightly more intense one. Here there's more energy. There's more stuff happening. It's a bigger room. And then there's a low energy cafe, which is this one coming up. I'll just wait till it comes in. Here it is. Right? There's just less people.
Yeah.
Just a smaller space. And I found myself instinctively going into each one of these cafes physically in different times. And I started thinking, that's weird. Why is it? Am I sort of subconsciously choosing something? And I was. Absolutely, I was. I was the first guinea pig. And then I started testing this with loads of users, you know. And we found...
What actually created this idea? Was it like going to the cafe and finding that you worked well with different sounds in the background? Like, I know you come from the music industry and I'd love to hear a bit about that. But what was that connection where you thought this could be something?
Well, I'll start with this if I can. If you've ever listened to the radio, you probably know this.
Absolutely.
You've heard that before. I was the founder of the band. I was the white guy playing this guitar. This was a long time ago. This was in the 90s. So I've got a background as a songwriter and a performer and a composer. That's, you know, one of my best known things, but I've done lots of stuff, you know, movies and all kinds of things over the years. I knew as a performing musician that the sequence of songs, what the DJ would call a playlist, right, really influences the way people feel. Have you ever been at a wedding when the wedding DJ has played the wrong song?
Yes, absolutely. That's so funny. I was just talking with some girlfriends about that last Friday, about a DJ that would play the wrong song at the wrong time.
We're now going to slow things down a little bit, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to play the... We're like, what?
You're like, are you reading the room here?
What's with that? So I knew that there is a skill, you know, playing in a live band, there's a skill to having the set, you know, reflect the audience, the energy of the audience, and great DJs are masterful at doing that. They're just fantastic. So after I was in the band in the 90s, I'm an inventor. My dad's an inventor. I come from a long line of inventors. And me and another couple of guys started a company that invented some technology that networks recording studios. Now, it's kind of technical stuff. There's a company called Avid who make the video editing and audio editing tools, the pro stuff that all the major studios in Hollywood use. Mm-hmm. And we invented a thing called DigiDelivery, which then became Avid Cloud Collaboration. If anybody listening to this works with professional video or audio, they'll know this stuff. When I quit the band, stopped being a musician, then moved to San Francisco, went into startups, ran a, you know, I then had like 70 employees. We built this thing. It was fascinating. We sold it in 2003. I went from being the boss of the company to working. I had to then, because when we sold the company, I had to work at Avid and I had an office. And first time ever, I had a day job. Yeah. And I used to have to sit in my office at my day job trying to do stuff. And I'd be like, oh, I'm not sure I can do this.
Right.
I used to be on tour in a band.
Now they have you strapped to a desk.
Yeah. And then when I had my own company for the 9 years before we sold it, I had all, you know, I would go for a walk on the beach. I'd be thinking about what I was doing. I'd be in cafes. But now I had a corporate job. And I found it like, oh, insanely challenging. And that's what had me starting to go, well, maybe if I know about playlists, I bet there's a playlist of some kind of music that will help me do this damn job I'm doing. And that led me to asking a lot of people, what kind of music do you listen to when you're working? Mm-hmm. And I found that there were sort of two basic camps. There was people that like trance electro, you know, dance music, and people that like classical music. And I'd be like, well, what kind of music do you like? And a lot of folks said, well, I can't really ever find anything that I want to set it and forget it. I want to just find the kind of thing I like and you know, just hit play on it. Right. And services like, you know, Pandora here in the States and Spotify, they have these focus playlists and they kind of work some of the time, but then they'll play you something and you're like, what? Hey.
And that immediately breaks your focus, right?
You're immediately out of the focus bubble.
And you know what I see as such a valued resource here, though, is someone could potentially create a playlist, but I'm guessing that what allows you to focus isn't your jamming out playlist that you'd listen to in the car. And so it's not as fun to put a whole playlist together of what actually allows you to focus. And being able to use your program and just hit play and not have to be able to curate it for yourself.
Imagine drinking cocktails while you're working. That is not for working. That is for after work. Do not be chugging on a whiskey while you're working. It is not that. And listening to music you know and you like and you love while you're working is doing exactly that. You're distracting yourself. Mm-hmm. It's music that's designed to dance to or to sing along with, and it will distract you. It will distract you. Your non-conscious attention will be listening to it and going, hey, Amber, do you remember that time? And you'd be like, oh, no, not now, I'm working, you know.
Right, because music can bring not just emotion, but so many memories.
Yeah.
Actually, this just happened last night. Some song came on and it was from the 90s. And I was like, to my son, he's 11, I was like, listen to this. And then he didn't care. And then I went to the next 90s song and it was just flooding back all these memories. Next thing I know, I'm sitting right in the kitchen by myself on my phone. Kit doesn't care. But for me, it was memory after memory of what I used to listen to.
Yeah, for me, that would have been one bad relationship idea after another.
Yes.
Anyway, yes. Why don't we ever learn those things? Oh, somehow we don't. But you remember the music that you were listening to while you were in them, you know?
You do. So I'm actually interested in using this for my son. So my son is almost 11 years old and he's homeschooled right now, obviously COVID. And he has accumulated this habit of listening to audiobooks whenever his teacher's not actually talking. So the whole time he's working, the whole time he's on his computer all day. And at first, my knee-jerk reaction was, hey, kid, turn that off, focus and work. He's like, Mom, it helps me to focus. He, at 10 years old, had enough insight to feed back to me, hey, Mom, it helps me focus. And I'm like, but aren't you listening to the story? He goes, no, I only listen to the ones that I've heard so many times I already know the story. So he's listening to it for like that white noise. And I thought, oh my gosh, this program, Focus at Will, could be so beneficial for him as well.
Dr. Ned Halliwell, who is our science advisor in Focus at Will, explained how ADD works to me in very simple terms. And if we can spend 2 minutes, I'd love to explain how he described it to me. He said, people who have ADD or people who have problems consistently being distracted when they're trying to do something, we all have a clock at the back of our brain. And you know, when you see row teams, there's someone going pull, and then everybody is like rowing like this, you know, it's like a bunch of people all pulling on the things. And the person at the back goes pull, and then they pull, and then they go pull, and they go pull, right? Yeah. You can see that. And for those of you that are listening to this on the radio or the podcast, I'm moving my hands as if I'm rowing.
That's right. You guys don't get to see them.
Yes. Well, what happens is in our brains, our non-conscious attention has a clock in it, and it is saying to me, concentrate on Amber. Concentrate on Amber. concentrate on Amber. And my conscious brain is going, yes, sir, no problem. Concentrate on Amber. And it's this clock saying, do this, do this. People who have ADD, that clock is running slowly. So if I have ADD, my clock goes, hey, you're talking to Amber, concentrate. Now my wandering brain is like, ooh, what's that out there? That's a bird on that tree. And then my clock goes, hey, concentrate time. I'm like, oh yeah, what were you saying? Sorry. And then I'm like wandering off. I'm going, squirrel, that looks like a squirrel to me. I'm hungry. And then my clock goes, talk to Amber. So my clock is actually running slowly, not fast. So the reason why stimulants and coffee and Adderall and, you know, the pharmaceuticals work is the clock is being sped up. So it goes, talk to Amber, talk to Amber, talk to Amber, do this thing, clock, clock. And it is like, you know, the skipper, are they called skippers when you're rowing? But the person at the back who's going pull is going pull, 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 and keeping me on task. That made a lot of sense to me, that people so people with ADD, that clock is running slowly. So you can do a few things to speed it up. Now, some jobs, having ADD, which is where you need a lot of stimulation to be able to focus on what you're doing, there are some jobs this is really important. How about being a first responder of any kind?
Mm-hmm.
You know, fire, medical, nurses, doctors. These are people who, when they're at work, it looks like chaos to the outside person. Doctor this, doctor that. Yes, if you know, oh my goodness, there is so much going on. Air traffic controllers. If you're a third grade teacher, you got to give, there's a lot going on. And I don't know if you've noticed, if you have any friends who work in any of those kinds of things, they're incredibly calm at work.
Yes.
Right? There's 40 kids screaming. They're like seven, half of them are trying to kill each other. What are you doing? And they're like, hi, I had a great day. Really?
That is so true. And that, and when they're good at their job, it's because that's where they excel in that environment.
So your lad, he's just like that. It's not a bad thing. In fact, the chances are he is incredibly talented at something. He's productive when he's being productive. It's just that he has figured out for himself. Listen, it's a little unfair. You're his mom and you're a productivity podcast. He must have overheard some of this.
He has. He's been a guest a couple of times. The things that come out of his mouth are mind-blowing sometimes.
Absolutely. But he has figured out that, what he's doing is he's adding stimulus, audio stimulus specifically, to his environment so he can concentrate, so that his brain, which needs to be told to keep concentrating on the task, has things to listen to. I have a friend who's a very successful Google engineer, and he listens to soccer. He's English, soccer in one. He has a speaker here with games on. He often is actually playing some kind of online game with another machine here. He listens to music over here. He has four things happening. And then he sometimes has a book on over here. Four different
things.
And you walk into his office and you're like, whoa.
And you know what I love about that is he didn't say, that's so weird. That shouldn't be that way. I should be able to be able to focus quietly. I love when people can just own who they are, listen to that voice, experiment, and find how they show up best. Like, that's my message.
Different.
Everyone is different.
Individual. We're individual aspects of the divine. That's how it's described. And we are.
I have, she's still a client, and she has a home office, and then she had a regular office with like colleagues, and she ran the office, right? And she's like, I don't know why I can't focus in my work office. It's not that people are interrupting me. It's not that, and she goes through the normal. And I said, all right, walk me through everything that is around you in your home office. And so when she did that, here's what she told me. She said that she has a fuzzy floor mat like on her feet, and she's barefoot. Mm-hmm. So she's like rubbing her feet on the fur.
Okay.
Judge Judy's on in the background. Some other things too, right?
Uh-huh.
And I said, I've seen you at your regular office. Don't you have a TV? And she's like, yes. And I was like, well, why don't you close your door and put Judge Judy on? And she's like, that is so wrong. Like, that's not acceptable, right? Like, that's not status quo. And I said, you know what's wrong is you not showing up your best. Right. Just humor me. Shut your door for an hour, turn Judge Judy on in the background and let me know how it goes. And you know what? She shut her door, turned Judge Judy on, went to Ross and picked her up another rug that was furry and recreated what worked for her in her home office for her work office. Yeah. And I said, forget what everyone says it has to look like. We want to do our best work.
I've got, I got a handful of other things that we found out that might be of interest. I do a lot of surveys. We got 2 million users in folks. Well, I do a lot of surveys and I find out stuff about people. And there's a few, like, again, kind of counterintuitive things that can be very distracting when you're working. The first one, and when you think about this, this is kind of obvious. Make sure that when you're working, you're pointing at the door. So if you're in an office, make sure your desk, ideally, is pointing towards the door.
Now, and do you know why?
Yeah, it's because if there is a possibility of someone sneaking up behind us, it makes us slightly concerned all the time that someone is going to come in and cause us harm. It's, if we were in a cave, you know, you and me having a cave beer, a cave cocktail back in the old days, right? We would be in the cave and we'd be keeping our eyes on the entrance to the cave in case a bear comes in or your husband comes home.
Yes. I mean, my husband's not in a cave, but 100% whenever we're in public, my husband is facing the entry everywhere. Restaurants,
it's a human thing.
Homes, it doesn't matter because he's his protector. He can't turn it off. And the only time he can relax a little bit is if he's positioned in the right place.
So if you're in an office, the ideal place is where you can see out of the window and you can see the door. It's not always possible, but trust me, that makes a huge difference. Second thing is the light source between the window and your computer. If the window is too bright, it's overpowering. It's glaring on your computer screen. If your computer screen is too bright, you'll find that it's a glare against the window. So what you need to try and do is during the most of the day, make sure that the light that's on the amount of lightness that's coming off of your computer screen matches approximately what the window is. And the best way of doing that is to close one eye, look out of the window and look at your computer screen. And if you do that, and when you look out of the window, it feels too bright, you'll find, you've either got to put some blinds on or turn up your computer screen so that it's brighter.
Wow.
It makes a huge, huge difference. And another thing now is make sure that when you're working, you have your feet flat on the ground.
Do you know what that does?
I have no idea why, but few people told us, make sure that your chair height is right. Mm-hmm. Because what we usually do is you move your chair height up and down to be perfect for your hands. Of course, otherwise you get repetitive strain in your hands, right? But often the height that you're at there means that you're just a little bit uncomfortable because you're either a little too far up or a little too low. So make sure. So you've seen those. You've probably seen
risers.
The risers.
Yes, I have those.
Put your feet on.
Yes.
Adjust them so that it feels completely natural and your feet can be flat. If your feet, by the way, are on the risers and they're at an angle, that can be weird too, because now that's not natural.
Yeah, I thought it was just old age. I had to get the risers for my feet because the back of my legs would fall asleep hanging over the chair.
Exactly. So now what's happening is that your body, your non-conscious mind is aware of that. And there's this like background thing that's happening in your body. Your body's going, my ankles are uncomfortable. It's going to stop you being productive.
Yes.
Next thing was hydration, which is related to sleep. If you didn't sleep well, you're not going to be that good. So that's a whole other conversation about sleeping. I'm not an expert on it, but I know that it's the thing. But hydration is really important. If you've just drunk 2 or 3 coffees, guess what it is? It's a diuretic. It's going to have you go to the bathroom, which is going to mean that you're going to be slightly dehydrated. So if you drink a coffee, drink a water. But don't drink too much water. because otherwise your body's going to be going, oh, go to the bathroom.
Yeah, right, right. You're not going to get in that flow. Well, you'll get in a flow stage. It's not the one you want.
And then the last thing is, you touched on this earlier, be really aware of the kind of audio that you need. What kind of place? Do you work best in a really busy office? Do you work best in a place where it's quieter, but you know on every, you know, every hour someone will come by and ask you a question?
Mm-hmm.
You know, does that work best for you? Just be really conscious of what works best for you. And the last thing, this was fascinating. I did a survey to 25,000 of our most engaged users, and I said, what's your biggest problem at work? What is it? What is it? I mean, it might have been, I'm not earning enough money. I'm, you know, I don't like my boss. What is the big problem?
Mm-hmm.
And the answer to the first question was happy. I'm not happy at work. I want to be happy when I'm working.
Mm. That's so sad.
I know. And then we said, well, what do you do? And they said, I like to listen to music. I was like, okay, we can help. So what helps you be happy at work is I listen to music. And then what happens when you listen to music when you work? Well, it makes me more productive. There is a link between being productive at work and being happy at work. You know that. That's why you've got this podcast.
I totally know that. I mean, we're able to see each other. No one else was able to see my face, but I, you know, that's the language I use all the time, is like, we just want to show up our best. Like that is like innate in who we are. Mm-hmm. And if we think it's our job to show up our best, and for me, you know, we're speaking to business owners, right? And so I feel that when you are being productive, you feel better about yourself because you know you're serving the world in the special way you can serve the world. Yeah. And the opposite is true too. When you show up every day and you feel like you're on a hamster wheel and you're not making any progress and you're frustrated with yourself, it affects your self-esteem, your confidence, everything. I really agree with that.
Yeah, we found it. You have this, the definition of productivity for us in Focus at Will is helping someone find their flow state. And when you're doing something, and it could be anything, it could be, you know, you deeply dived into a spreadsheet doing some analytical work. It could be I'm writing a new blog post. It could be I just finished the perfect novel for my new chapter in my new novel. But we all know this feeling. And there are three things that define a flow state. One is while you're doing it, you lose sense of time.
Mm-hmm.
It's timeless. The second thing is that you get this sense of happiness, this fulfillment. And then the third thing is a little more amorphous. It's that I feel at one. There's no me doing this. It is all one. I am connected to I'm connected to my spreadsheet. Hey.
Yes.
But you're familiar with the feeling. You're like,
I am very familiar with the feeling.
The sense of self disappears. And that is so beautiful when that happens.
It is absolutely beautiful. And I feel like, you know, for so many people, they just reactively, they just figure it out every day, right? And yet when I ask what they want more of, they want what you're explaining is that flow state. And for me, I believe personal responsibility is a huge thing. And I'm like, then it's your job to figure out how to recreate that. Like, tell me, what was the temperature of the room? Was the lights on? Had you just eaten a big meal? You know, was there background noise, music?
Right.
Figure out your special focus formula and then do it on purpose. And then imagine what you can create in the world and how happy you would be if you can create that for yourself.
Yeah, awesome. I'm a big fan of just thinking about humans as being happy and productive at the thing that they're doing for work. If you are fulfilled and if you're being productive, you're not wasting time. We started this interview about talking about not wasting time. And time is the most precious resource we have. You never get it back.
Absolutely.
And I would, if I'm working for someone I would want to be productive while I'm working at my job for someone else, because that means that I'm going to be in line for promotion. I'm going to be in line for pay rise. I'm going to be happy at what I'm doing. I am of real value to my company. If there's a problem, if there's a recession, I'm one of the employees that is unlikely to be let go because I'm all of these things. If I'm working for myself and I've got a task to do, which might take me 10 distracted hours or 5 really productive hours, that's 5 hours I can go hang out with my dog, my family. I'm on the beach. I live in LA. I live out right on the beach. I mean, I'm talking to you now. It's 2:46 in the afternoon. I got to go in a minute. You know why? Because I got to get on the beach before it gets to sunshine, you know?
Yes, the beach is calling you. And, you know, one thing we didn't speak about either is that music has a way to reduce your stress.
Oh, yes. Right?
So even if you're doing something you don't absolutely love, or I would imagine the opposite of the survey that you got was that so many people feel so stressed from work and, you know, in the middle of a pandemic, lots of personal stresses. And if you can get in your flow state and feel productive and you're a contributor to your business or your company and you get to listen to music, how great is that?
Well, I would love to just end talking to you. Talking about something which is really exciting for me in Focus at Will. We have this new area of our system called Artists Channels. And Artist Channels are, most of the channels on the system are collaborations and compilations of many different artists who we've got under contract to the company. And so there'll be different tracks by loads of different artists. But this new area is called Artist Channels. And there are a couple of new artists going live this week. One of them is, it's called Zen Piano. And I will play you a little tiny burst of Zen Piano. It sounds like this. That's a little loud, I think. This whole channel sounds like this. Jason Campbell is the composer. He's from Phoenix, Arizona. And he's a very successful New Age piano player. And he talks about how the magic happens in the gaps between the notes. Now, people like your son and me, this doesn't work well for working at all. But it works great for me when I want to just calm down a little bit. So we have this channel. It's called Zen Piano. It's unique to us on Focus at Will. And we just launched it, and it's already in the first 10 days it's been launched. It's the number one ambient channel on the system.
I love that.
Kind of exciting. But the most exciting thing for me is I played you some of my music earlier on that everybody knows. That was my band London Beat. And I have a new channel, which is all my music on Focus at Will, and it's called Nature Beat. And I'll play you a little burst of Nature Beat. You ready?
Yes.
The sounds of nature. And a sequencer. Depending on the kind of brain type you have, this channel may or may not work for you. But I launched this channel on the system about 4 weeks ago, and it is now the number one channel on the system.
They love it.
They love it. I'm happy to say I'm glad they loved it.
That is so great.
And the reason that, as we're talking, the music in the background is just a bleepy synthesizer. These tracks are 25 minutes long and they take you on a 25-minute journey. And it always takes a minute to wind into the track. So this is Nature Beat. You can find it on the Focus at Will system. If you're interested in looking at either Focus at Will or Nature Beat, naturebeat.com is where this all sits and tells you more about it.
Absolutely. I cannot wait for my listeners to take a trial and like, you know, see how this works and which channels work best for them and really just explore experimenting. I can imagine that it's not just brain types, but also the different work you do. When you said artistry channel, I was thinking that it was a channel. My first thought was maybe it was a channel for when you're doing creative work versus spreadsheets. Maybe that uses a different type of your brain or part of your brain. And I would imagine that you could figure that out for yourself too. It's like when I'm getting into deep creative work, what do I want to hear? And when I'm getting into mundane work that's not fun, what do I want to hear?
So here's what's weird about what you've just said is it sounds completely intuitive and I am nodding going, yeah, you'd think that when I'm doing my taxes, I need different music than when I'm doing my art. It turns out that your brain, the flow state that you need to get into to do either of those two things is triggered by the same exact audio stimulus.
Well, so, that's good news. That's less to figure out.
Right? Once you figure out what kind of audio, what kind of sound, what type of music helps you get into a flow state, you can then do taxes or creative or cooking or, you know, because it's your brain reacts in the same way.
Oh, that's awesome. Well, thank you so much. Before we close out, is there anything else you'd like to share about your company or Focus at Will?
Yeah, we're based here in California. We're in, the head office is in LA. And we were, our initial investors were Singularity University, which is part of the Google world. And we became, we're a business that's based on this intersection between art and science and productivity, which is why we're talking today. And there are this thought of being productive. I grew up in England, and there was a thing in England back in the day, which was called a time and motion study. And the factories and the workers used to have a team come in and check their time and motion study. But really what they were doing is they're looking for productivity.
Yep. The efficiency of movement. Yep.
Right. And so what's fascinating about, for me, and why I'm so passionate about Focus at Will still, is that there are these hidden drivers, in this case, music, that affect us deeply when we're doing things. I talked earlier on about light. Mm-hmm. Make sure that the window isn't brighter than your computer. And there are all of these subtle and small things that impact us. And the quality of life change, you just by moving each one of these little things a little bit, like get some blinds on your window, make sure you're hydrated, try and get a good night's sleep. And it'll change your fundamental happiness, which is actually priceless. And of course, listen to Focus at Will.
That's right.
I'm sorry, I had to, but
no, please do. I listened to it before we jumped on today. I did my own research. But again, I'm going to close out the same way I opened with, is that I was looking forward to this interview because I was curious, and you have been able to answer my questions and really fill in some gaps, things that had intuitively come up for me just through coaching and working with clients and hearing things over and over. So just like your surveys where you're like, that's counterintuitive, but this is what people are saying. And I when I learned about Focus at Will, I was like, this makes so much sense. And I jotted down stories of where this makes sense in my life and experiences to prepare for today's interview. So thank you so much for taking the time and it's reaching out and being a wonderful guest and really turning us on to your company, Focus at Will.
And I am Will at focusatwill.com. And I love to hear stories of people's productivity. So reach out to me, say hello, and tell me your tips.
Absolutely. We will be sharing everything about how to get Focus at Will and how to share your story with Will in the show notes of this episode. Thank you so much for being here today. Thanks so much for joining me today and listening in on my conversation with Will. I found it to be incredibly interesting and fascinating, and I hope you did too. I hope you're walking away asking yourself, how do I show up my best? How can I create more blocks of time where I am focused and doing my best work? I've loved having you listen to this episode of Productivity Straight Talk, but no change, no change. Without taking action, nothing will change for you or your business. So don't take this episode as just another opportunity to learn something and not take action. My guess is as you listen to this interview, you were telling yourself, this makes a little sense for me, or that's interesting. I have found that I, you know, find focus and do my best work in some of the most odd places, but I've been fighting it. It's not normal. It's not right, or it shouldn't be that way. I want you to stop telling yourself that. I want you to start getting curious and ask yourself, why is that? You know, right after I had this interview with Will, I was talking with one of my coaching clients in a coaching session, and he brought up something very similar to this situation in which he was able to get some incredible amount of work done working in his backyard with the sun on his face, sitting in a lounge chair, barefoot, feet in the grass. And he's like, but that's not possible. Like, I have an office, I have employees, like, I have what my normal work week looks like. Why is that weird that I was able to get such great work done? And first and foremost, it is not weird at all. But my question to him was, what pieces of that can you take to the office? What pieces of that can you carve out in your work week? Because if he was able to get, honestly, he said 6 to 9 hours of work that would have taken during the week, 6 to 9 hours, he got done in 3 hours. And so my challenge to him was, well, what if you took a Friday afternoon off? What if you went into the office a little bit later on a Wednesday and did that focus work for 3 hours and then came in to support your team and have the meetings and meet with your clients? You've just reclaimed 3 to 6 hours a week because you weren't struggling to get it done in the midst of all the distractions, or you weren't finding your flow. That's an incredible investment of time. You're getting 6 hours back for a 3 hour investment if you have the courage to lean into unlocking what works for you and then doing it on purpose, even if it doesn't make sense. And that is my encouragement to you, the listener of Productivity Straight Talk, is that we truly owe it to ourselves. We owe it to our businesses. We owe it to our team to really give ourselves the best ability to show up. All right. So at the beginning of the episode, I shared with you a little bit about how we support you in finding your freedom to focus, your ability to focus and do your best work inside Leverage Lab. If you're thinking that you would love some additional training and support around freedom to focus, among a lot of other amazing topics regarding productivity and time management and building your business, I will invite you to head on over to amberdelagarza.com/leverage lab. Check it out and see if it's a fit for you. I would love for you to join us inside Leverage Lab so that I can support you through training and coaching. All right, so that's my straight talk for today. Until next time, have a productive week.